Dorberg's Craftsman on BCTV is supported by the Kutztown Folk Festival and by the Reading Berks Guild of Craftsmen.
Good evening and welcome to tonight's edition of Your Berks Craftsman. I am Kay Bennecoff, your host, and I'm going to take you into the world of theorem painting. Now, you may think that this is going to be about equations on canvas, but no, it is not. Tonight we have with us a lovely artist who has been with our Reading Berks Guild of Craftsmen for approximately 8 years. She is also a juried member with Lehigh Valley, a juried member of the Pennsylvania State Guild. Let me introduce Joan Dunham tonight.
Hi.
Hi, Joan. How Hello. Are you?
I'm very well, thank you.
Okay, Joan has traveled tonight from Glenside, Pennsylvania, and as I stated, she is taking us into the world of theorem. It is not about equations, right?
No.
Nope. Okay. No, so you will not see any theorems on canvas tonight, okay, but you will see theorems on canvas, but in a much different light with paints. How did you get started on this, Joan?
I got started, we moved to Rochester, New York in about 1973, and while we were up there, I visited someone's home, and she had a bench that was stenciled on the back with silver and gold powders. And I said, oh, I love that. I've always wanted to learn to do it. And she said, well, there is a class going to begin up here pretty soon, and we had not yet moved up. We had just gone up and just picked out our house. But I went back to our hotel and had the information and was signed up for the class before we actually moved to Rochester. And I started out stenciling with bronzing powders on, oh, I did a rocking chair and a little box and a number of things. And then when our time ended, our class 8-week session ended, I was invited to come back and continue painting with our teacher at her home. So every Monday, while we lived in Rochester, I gathered my things and we went to Betty Goodwin's house and painted. And I continued doing the stenciling with bronzing powders, and I tried some country tin paintings, such as Pat Oxenford does. Mm-hmm. And then one day I saw somebody do a theorem. And when I saw that theorem, I thought, oh, this is really fun. This is something I think I'd like to try. So this was my very first theorem.
Okay, can we zoom in on that? That is a typical theorem, right?
It's a typical theorem, a peach with some peach blossoms. And it's an old frame that my instructor had we antiqued to make it look even older. And I brought it along. I hadn't looked at it for a while, and when I got it out, I realized it's a perfect thing to bring because it's the perfect thing not to do with a theorem painting because I did not know better at the time, and it's mounted on a piece of ordinary cardboard. And if you see all the little brown spots, they're known as foxing. And this happens when you put fabric or even anything that's worth saving on paper against ordinary cardboard, it will deteriorate. What happens is there is lignin and there is acid, tannic acid, in the cardboard, and it actually leaches through into your picture and makes spots, and ultimately it can destroy the fabric because it's the reason. Years ago, all paper was made of rag. Mm-hmm. When I was growing up, you had a rag man come around. Paper was made of rag because the only fabrics you had were either wool or cotton or linen, and those things could easily be turned into paper. Now that we have synthetic fabrics, you can't use that. So paper now is made from wood pulp, and wood pulp has a lot of tannic acid in it, and that in turn, that's why the books in the Library of Congress are all failing, because the tannic acid is destroying the paper.
And that's why in the craft stores, it tells you about, on your mountings when you do pictures and everything, to use the acid.
Yes.
Acid-free.
So I use acid-free backing board now, and it's all rag. No no plant fibers, and I now use a glass that is light. It's called conservation glass, and it cuts back only something like 0.3% of light will go through. The glass is coated so that the light is reflected actually back away, and the paintings will not fade mm-hmm. over time.
Right, not nearly as much as they did. Mm-hmm. I mean, it still certainly can, but not
tiny bit, but not half as much.
Right.
Theorem, I've learned over time, got started because the English were developing a trade with China for the beautiful white porcelain. And while they were in China, they began to see these paintings that were called pith paintings. I don't know if you can see these close up. These were typical of the pith paintings. Mm-hmm. And they were made, what they did was they actually could slice off thin layers of the pith layer from under the bark on a particular kind of tree that grows in China. And that pith paper had a fibrous texture. Mm-hmm. And when they painted on it, it absorbs color, so you get much more of a richness and a depth of color in the pictures. It's much deeper than what you get on paper. Last summer, when I was up in Vermont for some classes, I took some lessons, and this was one of the pith paintings that I did. It is on paper.
Okay.
And actually, I did two of them. I'm not going to bring the other one out right now. But.
And what makes it, why do you call it the pith painting? Because of the design of it?
Because it's done on this pith, which is a fibrous, fuzzy texture. And the English had no access to this pith paper.
Correct.
Because of the fact that it came from this tree that only grows in one particular area in China. So the English didn't have access to that. But their velveteen, which is like velvet with a crew cut, has a fibrous similar texture, and it accepts the color very similarly.
So that's what the English
used. They started out using the paper when they could, or the fabric. They did also paint on paper occasionally, and they even painted bedspreads, used linen or whatever fabric they had, but the preferred thing was the velvet because it had such a nice rich texture.
Okay, now may I ask you a question though?
Yes.
On when you're talking about the Chinese and their pith. Mm-hmm. Now, was that a painting then, or was it in the theorem category that we're saying with stencils? Do you think that they painted?
I think that it was done with stencils. I'm not 100% sure.
Okay.
I think quite often they were done with watercolor, but I think they were done with stencils, just as I did these with stencils when I took my class.
Okay, right.
So.
Okay.
And the English were trying to copy this idea, and they didn't have the strange fruits that some of there's some fruit in here that's fascinating. The center fruit in here is a relation to an apple that only grows in China and I guess in the Far East. And it is actually known as the hand of
Buddha
because it resembles fingers.
Fingers.
And the only way I found out about it, I was watching Antiques Roadshow one night, and they had a little cinnabar box, which is layers of red lacquer built up, and then they carve through it. And it has had this very same piece of fruit, and that's where I learned that it is a Chinese plant, and it is related
to
the apple.
So that was when you first recognized,
mm-hmm.
you know, you're there.
So Bob, kind of fun
get that
to
picture,
find.
Right? You know,
yeah.
Look what's on the Antique Roadshow, right?
So you learn a lot from all different kinds of places. So I thought I'd just show you a little bit of how this works tonight. Start.
Well, first off, just a question though.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, some of our viewers may not realize when you say painting, you're painting, but not like stroking. You are using a stencil.
I am using a stencil. I have a series of stencils. I'm not sure whether it's. This one is a clear mylar that I made, and I've discovered that if you have a laser copier, you can run a picture, print, onto Mylar film, which is the same thing they make overhead projector.
Oh, okay.
Sheets. You use the sheets to make overhead projector papers. Well, that works very well if you have a laser projector, so that I don't have to make four copies of this. I reduced the size of this drawing, but I didn't want to make four separate copies. So running it through the copier, I can get four that are all exactly the same. Because what you have to do when you do a theorem is you have to, the reason it's a theorem, it follows a plan. Geometry, it's a numeric plan. In theorem painting, what determines the theorem or the plan is where things lie in relationship to one another. No two things that touch one another could be on the same stencil, even if they're the same color. So these two plums, because there is a line in between them, if they were on the same stencil, you would have one big opening. You wouldn't have
the definition.
The definitions of space. Mm-hmm. So you planned it out. You didn't want to have any more stencils than you needed or do any more drawing than you needed. So you planned it out by numbering your parts, 1, 2, 3, and 4, assigning them numbers on where they were in relationship to one another. So this is a smaller version of this particular piece of grouping of fruit. And this, this is the one that I'm working on. It's actually a smaller part of this. This was a very common thing for people to do, that find a picture that they wanted to do as a theorem. They might not have wanted to do the whole thing. So they they'd only pick out certain parts of it that they would do. So I thought tonight I would just do just a little bit of this and show you how I put the color on. Work with a very dry brush, so I am rubbing almost all the color out of my brush. It should not color my skin, but I'm not sure if you can see, but
we can hold that up then, but you're doing like a circular motion. It's not much like a paintbrush,
right? Going more from the outside in. It was a brush that had bristles about this long when I started, but I've about worn it out. These are actually a kind of fur. I believe they're badger fur, which is very soft. When I first started doing theorem, the brushes were made of plant fiber, I think at Cecil, and it was very harsh, and when you stenciled, it would actually pull the pile. It would pull the pile out of the fabric. This is just much easier to work with because they're softer and they don't damage your fabric quite as much. Excuse me.
Oh, certainly.
Allergies are terrible.
Allergies
things.
Are bad, yeah.
So now I'm going to put some...
Bad time of the year.
Going to do some of the green on the upper side of the pear. Rub from the outside, always from the outside in.
And that helps you with the shading
toward
of
the
that?
Middle, correct. And it helps with the shading. When you're doing theorem painting, you're shading the way you would shade something if you were working with watercolor. If I were doing an apple with oil paints, you would color your whole apple the darkest red of your oil paint, the entire thing. Then as you want it to appear lighter, you add a little bit of white, a little more white, so that you get to a very light color in the center, and that gives the shaded effect. Mm-hmm. When you're doing theorem, you're using you're wanting that opening in the middle just as well, but you're letting your fabric show through to get that.
And because of the nap of the fabric, that also helps with the shading.
Yes, it does. Yeah.
You have a lot going on in a theorem painting. You have this cutting of the stencil, and you have a lot of work into that, and then applying the stencil to the project, to the picture, and then keep layering that, and then doing the painting, you know.
No, I pretty much finished this pear. Now I'm going to do this. Is tiny little bit down here is the leaf that's bending upward.
Okay.
And I think I have and here's another bending leaf.
So how many stencils are required?
There are four.
Four for this one. Okay.
Now if I take this off.
And you can see how pretty this is. It's like magic. There you go.
There.
And you can see how quickly that was done. Yeah, it looks beautiful.
And the interesting thing, if you run your, it's done
it's
with
dry.
Oil paint.
And it's dry.
But it's dry enough yeah. that you can't.
Yeah, that's amazing.
You don't, because you've rubbed the paint into it and worked with such mm-hmm. a dry brush, your color is being absorbed into the pile rather than resting on top mm-hmm. of it. People think of oil paint as being stiff and thick.
Mm-hmm.
But this.
Well, which it is, though.
Which it
really.
Is normally
right.
when you paint
right.
with it. But this gives a totally different look.
Mm-hmm.
Now I'm going to have these out of order, but just for the heck of it, we'll put another one. You have to match up your shapes and your edges carefully.
And then that's why you tape it down, right?
And
you know, that helps.
Tape it so that it can't move while you're
right.
painting. I don't, there it is.
Yes, and then again, with taping it down and putting not much paint onto the brush, that's how it doesn't leak underneath
mm-hmm.
there
yes.
for you.
Yeah. Now I'm going to try and do, this is going to be part of this peach. So
okay.
I'm going to use some yellow. I also don't do my colors the same way that many theorem painters do in that I guess we'll talk about color for a minute. My colors are basically Indian yellow, alizarin crimson is my red, and there's a Prussian blue here, which is a blue with has a slight green cast to it. And when I learned theorem, when I lived up in Rochester, our instructor up there insisted that you use basically those three colors and mix your other colors from them because they're okay. transparent oils, and that if you paint them over black, they will totally disappear because they're actually almost like a dye.
Okay.
There's no heavy pigment. Now I have one here, oxide of chromium. That does have ground up oxide of chromium mm-hmm. in it, which it's a green, and it will give you, it will make a darker and, to me, kind of a muddier color.
Okay. So these were the standard colors that
they
were, used back,
well, I
you
was
know.
Taught were the standard colors.
And then you if mix.
I mix almost all my colors mm-hmm. from them. Now, some of the newer books on theorem will have you picking. They'll have you go get a tube of sap green if you need a yellowy green. My teacher just said you just mix your green and
sure.
you try to get it mm-hmm. to the color of sap green. So I had a...
Well,
I
you're using
old,
the primary colors, right?
Mm-hmm.
And then you
and
mix them
basically,
and
basically, most of my colors sure. are mixed from those three.
Sure. That's how color originates or how we get the varying shades anyway,
yeah.
so... I found it interesting. Joan brought these paints in here tonight, and she didn't have tubes. She had this right on this paper. She just whipped it out of her suitcase, and it was here. So it so this isn't. It's not very. It doesn't dry quickly either. I mean, it's very workable for
this,
a long period of time.
This I actually had in the refrigerator. I brought it. I mixed it yesterday because I had planned to paint last evening, and then something happened and I never got to it. So I simply put it, covered it with aluminum foil and put it in the freezer. And be
okay.
And it will last for a day or two if you treat it carefully like that, kind of seal it with the foil.
Okay, so that's another trick of the trade here that you've shared with us tonight. So you're, when you buy the paints, then they are in tubes.
Mm-hmm. Regular Winsor & Newton, or mainly Winsor & Newton oil colors.
Mm-hmm.
They're the ones that are, fairly easy to get, and they're a good quality. I get the better. They make a grade called Winton, which is a student grade.
Okay.
But their professional grade watercolors, mm-hmm. I think, hold up.
And you can find those in the
Any
craft
the
stores
craft
that
stores,
were
yeah.
used to seeing, okay?
Yeah. They usually have the nicer ones locked up, so you have to ask for help.
Oh, okay.
With them, but
a little seems to go a long way, right?
A tube of paint will last me well over a year, because what I actually, the way I started, I put my globs of paint out here on the top, and then I would take a little of each one
and mix your colors.
And mix my colors down on my palette. And there were some people in my class in New York who would paint, they would just have a yellow streak and a blue streak and a red streak, and they'd make a green streak and maybe use that oxide of chromium. But one person in the class would do it this way, where she'd mix them, and I can go from the darkest green on this end up to a very pale yellow green on this end, all in that one thing.
Yeah.
My yellow can go from a pale yellow down to almost an ochre. This is from yellow to yellow orange to deeper red orange, pretty much red, and I add burnt umber to all my warm colors, which tones them down a little bit so they're not bright, vivid, hit you in the face colors.
Yeah, so and interestingly, when we reflect back on how Theorem, you know, started from the English, seeing it in China, I think you told me they go there to the port of Canton and
To get the white china.
Right. So then that's when they saw these paintings originally, the pith paintings, and then brought that back to England. And then the girls, the colonial, let's say back here in the United States then, we brought it here to the United States. And our young girls would learn Theorem painting in their studies.
As part of their studying. I was reading last night, it was kind of interesting. It said that when it came to America and when they began, that the Chinese paintings were exquisite and that the first English paintings were exquisite. But once they began to turn it over and have schoolgirls do it, the craft really began to go downhill.
Oh, really?
Which I thought was interesting. One of the books that I had read said that they got to be so bad that that's why Theorem painting stopped. That, although the other thing I've heard is that it really stopped when prints became available. In the mid-1850s, I think Currier and Ives prints became available.
Okay.
And I brought along one of my favorite, paintings. This is a wonderful book, by the way. The Art of Theorem Painting, it's written by two women who were part of the Historical Society of Early American Decoration. Mm-hmm. Big mouthful. And they published this wonderful book on the history of Theorem. And in addition, they have a number of antique theorems all throughout the book. And one of my favorites is, wait till I get to it here.
She has them here, yes.
This is a good example because you can see the cat. This was the original, this was a print, I think it's 1846. Of the three kittens. And someone had used it to make a theorem. So here's the small theorem that they made. Then these two women who are members of the Historical Society of Early American Decoration had access to a lot of these old stencils, and they came out with a series of them. You could buy them. So this was their version of the cat, the three cats.
And I think on the other side, are they bigger?
And on the other side, this.
There you go.
Someone that I knew asked me if I would paint the three cats to look like her cats. So this is her three cats that I used the stencil for.
And you changed their faces so that they
changed
look like her cats.
So they look more like her cats. change the eye color and what have you. And the other interesting thing, when I said people would sometimes take a design and just take part of it, this kitten is a book called The ABC of American Folk Art, and this little white kitten is the exact same cat.
Can I hold that for you, Joan? Yeah.
That is in here.
Oh, there he is. Yep.
This is what people would do. They would just copy part of something. They wouldn't necessarily do the whole thing.
So back in the day, they didn't have to worry about copyright laws.
No. Or at least they didn't.
Because Theorem, that's how a lot of things are done, because people see things that they like, and then they cut the stencils, they copy from that.
Okay. So that was how they did it quite often.
I think it went out of vogue because then they decided that girls had to start seriously learning other things, you know.
Partly, but it was taught to young women, because if you could, this is kind of the Jane Austen era, this whole, it's about 100 years, where you really had to get yourself a husband. That was your main aim in life. I mean, there were no jobs for women. And occasionally, if you were well-educated, you could become a teacher or a nanny. Mm-hmm. Or if you weren't educated, but you had the skill of spinning, you needed to get yourself some way to supply yourself with food and roof over your head. And that's why you became a nanny or whatever, or the spinster.
The
spinster was
the
brother or the sister who never managed to get a husband. And it's funny, because you look at somebody and you say, oh, she's a spinster.
Uh-huh.
And it's kind of a look down at somebody.
Yeah.
And I was reading that it was a very difficult job to be the spinster the nanny, because you weren't looked upon as being worth as much as somebody who managed to have a husband and was therefore the head of a household, managed a house, and had some responsibility. As a nanny, or you were kind of looked down on. If you worked in a house where they had servants, the kind of below stairs crowd, if you've watched Upstairs, Downstairs, they didn't want to have much to do with you, because they considered you still upstairs, because you were possibly related to some of the people upstairs. So they were not going to let you in on what life was really like downstairs, and all little secrets that were going on. And the people upstairs were kind of looking down on you. So you were in a limbo, and it was not an easy existence.
That was very interesting. Yeah. Yes. You know, so you think it just went out of, it just, because we didn't do it as well as the English did.
And also because prints became available. This was the era when the Courier and Ives prints and pictures like that cat one became available for people to buy much less expensively than before.
But then probably in 1976, with the revival of the arts and with crafts, you know, I mean, Theorem like range, you know, and so I see a lot of, you know, people. There is a famous person right in our neighborhood, actually, okay?
Down here in the red frame. On the easel.
Over there.
On the easel is a copy of a theorem by David Ellinger, who was from Trapp. He grew up was a young man in the era of the WPA, and artists were starving, just like everybody else. And when Roosevelt started that, I can't even think of the whole real meaning, WPA's work.
It was, when they went out and worked, like they did the roads, did the bridges, you know.
Photography wasn't very advanced. There was very little good color photography, if any. And the Smithsonian hired artists to go in and paint watercolor paintings of the glass and the red pottery and the Fructer. they hired people to paint these things. And there is a book called The Index of American Design, which shows a lot of the prime pieces that the Smithsonian owned at the time. Mm-hmm. And David Ellinger was hired as part of the WPA project. And his job was painting, reproducing the Frochter, the Pennsylvania German Frochter, and pottery.
Okay.
And if you ever get a chance to see that book, you can find it in the library.
Okay.
These watercolors that these artists did are absolutely amazing. You think you're looking at photographs, but they're watercolor.
Okay, and those are available to see at the Smithsonian, or you said in a book?
You would have to get the book from the library.
Oh, okay.
But all the artifacts are things that are in the Smithsonian.
In the Smithsonian, what they did.
But David then... He was a very talented artist, and he began doing theorem, developed and did a whole lot of theorem himself there in while he lived in Trapp. He also did a lot of wonderful folk art, huge oil paintings, and he did blanket chests and all kinds of different things. But theorem is the thing I think that he's best
known
for. And his theorems are selling now. They run from $1,000 to $2,000, many of them.
When do you know when he passed away? He was...
About 10 years ago. I'm not sure exactly when.
Okay.
Yeah.
And he remained in this area.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, this was his home. Yeah.
And this book that I had mentioned before about early American decoration, one of the designs that you... that's here for people to copy. This is the color photo of it. But here on the previous page is the drawing with all the parts numbered so that you could make about four or five copies of that. And I think it needs five because the numbers go up to five. And you would cut, make your five copies, and you would cut all of the things that had one.
On one stencil.
And all of the things that say two, you would cut on the second stencil, and so on.
Okay, that's very important for the viewers to know that, because you would look at this and go, oh my goodness, how many stencils would I have to cut?
So there are actually five. But as I say, being able now to do it with overhead projection sheets with the Mylar makes it much, much easier. You used to have to either... They had to make their own tracing paper or stencil paper.
Yeah, tell us about that, Joan.
That was interesting.
You had to
take white drawing paper and you coated it with linseed oil and you let it dry for several days. And after it dried for several days, then you varnished it. And that had to dry for several more days. And by the time those two things were done, it made the paper both very tough and translucent.
Okay, so that stencil was durable. That could be used many times.
And then you laid that you found a bright window or a place where you could put the picture that you wanted to make.
Mm-hmm.
You laid your up to five layers, one at a time, on your picture and traced some of the apples and some of the peaches and some of the pears or whatever on each piece.
Mm-hmm.
And then had to cut.
And how do you? What instrument do you use for cutting your stencils?
I think I left it out in the other room in my paint box. I use just a number 11 X-Acto knife.
Okay.
And you can buy them in any craft store. And there's actually a new one that I absolutely love that I just got. Fiskars that make the scissors, the orange-handled scissors. They make a new little thing that will hold that 11 blade, and it fits. It fits over your finger. It is the neatest thing, and there's not half as much pressure. And it's very easy to control. You press it with your finger and thumb, but the way it's made, it's very easy to cut.
So that would be something, if someone was interested in trying to do this, you know, that would you would highly recommend that then. Okay, because, and the Mylar, is that what you use now today?
I use Mylar now. Mm-hmm. Before, I used to use architect's linen when I could get it, but that is impossible to find. The Mylar really needs to be about 4 mil. There's a woman she has a business called PJ's Stencils. She's from up in Massachusetts, and you can buy wider sheets of the Mylar from her. If you don't copy it aren't using it through a copier, you have to use an India ink and a very fine pen to do your tracing.
Okay.
And it has to be done with India ink that's permanent.
Okay.
And you would draw your tracing on your Mylar or whatever you're using for your stencil and then cut it. But it has to be India ink. If you try it with ballpoint pen or pencil, the first time you use your stencil, that color that you've drawn with makes the edge of, all around the edge of everything that you're drawing gray.
Okay, it outlines it for you.
It outlines it, yeah.
Which is something you don't want.
No.
No. Okay. Tell us, you were talking to me also when we were speaking. I was getting such an education on theorem and stenciling, how initially you would have to poke holes around the hole.
Oh.
Okay.
Another way that people would do velvet painting was you would take a drawing, such as this, and you would lay up tracing paper over it, and then you would make tiny pinholes with use a straight pin and just make little teeny tiny holes
all
around every single edge of everything in your picture. And then after you made that sheet of paper with all these pinholes, you would lay that sheet of paper down on your velvet and rub graphite or pencil shavings through. And when you lifted that thing off, you would have a picture that was just nothing but little, you would see the outline of everything, but they would all be just little tiny dots. Mm-hmm. But they didn't actually consider that theorem painting, because you have to rub your paint through the opening in the stencil for it to be called theorem.
Okay, and how did they first do that without brushes? You were telling me that also.
Oh, sometimes you would wrap a piece of the velvet or a piece of wool, a plain or a very lightly colored wool, wrap your around your finger, rub your finger into the paint, and then rub it through the holes. That's a great thing to do when you're trying to cover a big area. I don't have anything out here that has a big area like a mat under a bowl of fruit or something. Rubbing that velvet, the color into the velvet, and rubbing it through with a piece of velvet or wool onto your surface.
So you may find yourself doing that yourself.
Yeah, it makes it a much more even.
If you work
very carefully, it's
right.
Much more even than the layering you can get with a brush.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of my brushes I didn't bring in, but some of them are about twice this thick.
Twice that thick.
And the bigger ones are also better when you want to cover a large area. But I do so many small things, I pretty much stick to the smaller brushes.
Yeah. Well, let's talk about how you got started in doing theorems of real animals. And let's talk about how you did the very first one.
Well, first I started with, this was my cat stencil. It was from a greeting card that I had found. And from that greeting card, I made a stencil. And this, I've sold those first two, but this is the cat.
Mm-hmm.
And by flipping them over, you can change color, but it is the same stencil, but done with two different colors.
Mm-hmm.
And I did animals like that, mostly just cats, for quite a while. And then somebody came up to me at a show and asked me if I would paint her cat. And I was very hesitant to paint the cat. She gave me this picture. And I just kept putting off painting this cat. And every show, the shows were twice a year, she would come, spring and fall. Did you paint the cat yet? And I would say, no, I wasn't brave enough. And finally, did you paint the cat? And I said, no. And she said, well, the cat has died. And I said, well, then you don't want me to paint him. No, I still want you to paint him. So ultimately, from her photograph, I made my stencils. And these were, did I get it right here? The poor cat photograph has gotten manhandled since I did this, because this was years ago. But I laid my Mylar on traced used that pen mm-hmm. and traced
all around
him. And then I would use another piece. And for this one, this is what I
really
I get on here, right?
Then actually,
this
right?
was just. I may have it upside. I think this one was just to get the white.
Mm-hmm. You can see that.
And
yeah.
I had it ticked about 5 pieces, and by the time I was finished, I had the cat, and. There, I was so pleased with what came out. She bought him, but I did a second one so that I would have one. So then from that point on, I did a number of other cats for people. And then after the cats, along came, is the purple notebook?
Your notebook?
Yeah, we must not have brought it in. Anyway, I somebody came up to me and said, do you paint pigs? And I said, well, I paint a little tiny pig. And he said, well, if I sent you a picture, would you paint a picture of my pig? And I said, sure, I'll be glad to try. Well, the next thing in the email I got, it was email, 4 pictures of 4 potbelly pigs.
Yes.
And he asked me if I, and said in this note, he said, would you please do a portrait each, I gave me a size of each of these pigs. And I painted the 4 potbelly pigs. And I thought that I had them.
Yeah, I don't
and
think
we must
they're
have
in
left
here.
Them
we
outside.
We must have left them out there.
So,
but
I've
they
done
are very
pigs.
Cute.
And from the pigs, we went on to rabbits.
Yes.
And that's, this one has kind of become my signature.
This is your signature.
My signature bunny. And he is from a
and here is your bunny picture.
See, he is from a photograph okay. that I took when we were on vacation down in Chincoteague, Virginia.
Mm-hmm. I find it amazing that you do this. I mean, you know, you said that you weren't a painter before this, but you
no,
know,
I wasn't. And I have no sense of proportion. I have to have a drawing.
That's
so
okay.
This bunny started as this little teeny tiny photograph, and by accident, I was in CVS developing photos one day, and somehow or other, in trying to get it ready to place my order, I accidentally enlarged
him.
And when I enlarged it, I thought, I really like that. I think he'd really make a good theorem. So I took it home and made, first of all,
the stencil,
made my drawing. Which is really, it's hard to see on here,
mm-hmm.
but it matches uh-huh. up with him. And I again numbered my part, or this, I chose which ones. I did anything that had white, I made on, put, cut first mm-hmm. on my first stencil. And then I laid that, after I had cut it, I laid it on here and marked off with X's the places mm-hmm. that I had already cut. Then I laid on another piece of mylar
and cut
different pieces, different parts of him. So this is kind of under his chin and like his cheek and like down lower front of his body. And through a set of about 4 stencils, I was able to make
to come up with your bunny.
Come up with my bunny.
Yes.
So he's kind of my signature one. Since now I do bunnies that I thought I didn't stick one in, I guess. There's some little tiny ones.
Oh, yes.
That are,
oh, well, you don't have the tiniest ones.
Tiniest
but
one. I do some that are go from like 7 inch or inch wide.
Oh, my goodness. I know. You have the tiny, you know.
And these I brought. I don't know if you can get close enough to see. But the one here on my left is done on paper. The one mm-hmm. on this side is done on fabric. And I usually have them out at shows to show people. You can see the difference in the way the fabric accepts color compared mm-hmm. to the way the paper does.
Oh, yeah, yeah. It's remarkable.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, it almost looks like two different, I mean, but it is the same picture, yeah. you know. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, it gives it depth, and the color's different, too. Mm-hmm. Yes, very nice. Well, speaking of shows, Joan will be at our holiday show, which is coming up. Reading Burke's Guild of Craftsmen will be having their holiday show October 31st and November 1st out at the mm-hmm. beautiful Kutztown University campus. And Joan is always there. She's one of the very popular booths to go to. She always has her display very lovely. Do you do other shows throughout the year, Joan?
I will be, I'll be up in Moncton.
Okay.
And right near, is it Allentown? Reading, which is it closer to?
It's near
to?
Reading.
Moncton, near Reading.
Yes,
Moncton,
yes.
The...
I believe that's the, oh my goodness, in the middle of October.
It's the middle
right,
of October.
About 2 weeks before the holiday show.
Yes.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
I'll be there. This weekend I'm going to be down, not this week, next weekend I will be down in Greenwich, New Jersey.
Oh, okay.
Greenwich is a kind of a fun town. It's one of those towns that Tom forgot. It's near Delaware Bay. And to get to Greenwich, we go out from Bridgeton, New Jersey, and you drive out through farm country, mm-hmm. and then you see a sign, when sirens go off, seek higher ground.
Oh, okay.
And Greenwich is actually a 1700s town that's out, and it must be on like a little hummock.
Oh, okay.
Because you go through this marshy area, which will flood.
Uh-huh, okay.
So. And you want to be in Greenwich when the floods come, or you want to be over, you know, more on the mainland. But it has a lot of 1700s houses. It was written up in Early American Life magazine.
Nice.
As a very special little place.
Oh, okay.
So I'll be there. They have a craft show. It's all colonial, and mm-hmm. it's fun. And I'll be doing that this weekend. And then weekend after that, I'll be in Bordentown, New Jersey, first weekend in October.
Well, you're a busy lady.
Yes, keeps me busy.
And people can contact you, okay,
yes.
by calling
mm-hmm.
you, okay? And your phone number, if you said that we can tell your phone
yes.
number
mm-hmm.
out. Go ahead.
And I'm on Facebook. I don't have too much in the way of pictures on there yet,
mm-hmm.
but if anybody contacts me, somebody contacted me today through Facebook.
Oh, there you go.
Joan Dunham, and she wanted some chicken pictures, so... What I did was email her back mm-hmm. photos that I took with my iPad, and then if she's interested in them, she'll let me know,
right.
and I can paint them for her.
Okay, and you they can also notify you at jedunham@verizon.net,
mm-hmm.
and you said I may give your phone number,
yes.
right?
Mm-hmm.
So she loves to talk to people, and she'll give you quite an education, and you'll be so happy. After you're talking
I'm
with Joan.
Much better on the phone than the email.
So her phone number is 215-572-5089, and she'll be glad to hear from you.
Mm-hmm.
And do you ever, we are kind of getting down here to the nitty gritty,
mm-hmm.
so, but you highly encourage people to try theorem
oh,
painting,
definitely.
Right? You know, and
I have
yes.
a book there. This one is still available. Online, I think
okay.
they have it in Williamsburg.
Oh, okay.
And this is another one. This one, for somebody who's really, really, really beginning. This is from by Linda Brubaker, whom I think is from Lititz.
I believe so. Yes.
And it has wonderful instructions, step by
mm-hmm.
step, and it has some very. It has small, something as small as a bunch of berries. It gives you the drawing, tells you what things to cut on each stencil.
Mm-hmm.
She has listing for colors and all your supplies, and it is an excellent book. You can find that online
mm-hmm.
too. I know they have it in Williamsburg in the gift shop
mm-hmm.
and some
Great.
Other places.
Oh, okay.
Those are two good places. And the other one would be this, the Historical Society of Early American Decoration. HSEAD is the easy way. And they have an extensive library of theorem designs that you can get. And you can also join a local chapter of the HSEAD
Okay, and you can come out and come to one of our Reading Berks Guild of Craftsmen meetings. We meet every Tuesday, the first Tuesday of every month, and Joan and Bob, her husband, come up to our meetings, and so she would love to talk to you there. We'd love to have you there. Get interested, and but if you really don't want to do it, you can just buy one of Joan's lovely paintings. Okay. Well, paintings, not... They're theorems, not paintings. Okay, so please remember to tune in every the third Wednesday of every month to Your Berks Craftsman. We will be on again in a few weeks because we will be highlighting some of our craftsmen who will be at our upcoming show. So we'll be back on in a few more weeks and bring you those talented artists. And then again in November, I have Kim Ostromira on. We're going to be doing holiday decorating, so that'll be a good show to tune into. Joan, I can't thank you enough for coming here tonight.
Thank you for inviting me.
I think we introduced the people to the world of theorem tonight.
Okay.
Okay, until next time, thank you and good night.
Your Berks Craftsman on BCTV is supported by the Kutztown Folk Festival and by the Reading Berks Guild of Craftsmen.